So in the present session, we'll continue our discussion on product pricing. We'll discuss few more kind of pricing, and then we'll sum up our entire managerial economics course, since we have covered all the topics whatever we thought of covering in this typical course. So to start with, if you remember in the last class, we talked about the product pricing, mainly when the pricing is done on the basis of the product life cycle, and on that basis we generally talk more about the product skimming, and then we discuss about the pricing based on cyclical pricing, pricing based on this input output relationship. Then we talked about the Ramsey pricing and the transfer pricing. So we'll discuss some more types of product pricing now, and to start with we'll talk about peak load pricing. And in case of peak load pricing, it's a kind of price discrimination typically, in which consumers are segregated on the basis of time segment. So here it's not the same kind of pricing for the different consumer group, rather it's a different kind of price discrimination, different kind of pricing for the different consumer group. So it's a part of price discrimination. So rather than it's a pricing technique, we can say that it's a price discrimination technique. What we, and in this case generally we use this peak load pricing. So this is the kind of price discrimination which segregate consumer into different group on the basis of the time. So it's like user of consumer or user in a typical time period will charge more, user in the typical time period will be charged less. So in this case, different prices are charged for the same facility used at different point of time by the same customer. So even if it's the same customer, when he uses the product or when he uses the service at the different point of time, different pricing he has to pay. So typically this segregation is on the basis of the time, and here on the basis of time zone, the entire time zone is divided into two types, one is peak load and another is off peak load. And in case of peak load, generally higher price will be charged, and here the pricing model is markup pricing. And in case of off peak load, generally off peak load pricing, where there will be lower price will be charged, and the pricing is based on the incremental pricing. So the entire time zone is divided into two kind of time zone, one is peak load, another is off peak load. Peak load where activities are high, and off peak load is when the activities are less. So activities are high, in this case it's a higher price for the product or higher price for the service, and the pricing is on the basis of the markup pricing. And in case of off peak load, generally where the activities are bit less, there it will be lower price, and in this case the pricing technique is incremental pricing. Then the typical example of peak load pricing is, like, if you remember during the initial days when the cell phone service providers were there, or generally with the time period, they used to charge a different pricing. Like first 100 minutes, maybe you get a free services. Then next 100 local to local, the next 100 minutes will be charged in a different price, and the call up more than 200 units will be charged in a different price. Similarly, when this STD prices, if you look at, there were different pricing from morning 6 to 8, then 8 to 9, and again from 9 to evening 7 o'clock, it's the peak load pricing, because there the activities are more, and that's why it's a higher price. And after 7 to 9, there is half of the actual price. And after 9 o'clock or after 9 to 11, generally we used to get 1/3, and after 11 o'clock we used to get 1/4. So on the basis of the different time of the day, generally the STD rates were varying. And this is generally the example of the peak load pricing, where in the off peak load generally prices are less, and in case of peak load the prices are more. Similarly, if you look at typically in the, that is not being practiced in India, but in some foreign country, the energy prices are more, the electricity charges are more during the peak hour during the business hour, and energy prices were less during the off-peak hours. Then we have the sealed breeze build pricing strategy. Here it's a kind of separate market altogether. Buyer do not prefer the open price and demand sealed price from the seller in a sealed form. The typical example is tender here. So this is the example of limited monopsony, when there is only one buyer and the number of sellers are many. In this case, buyers do not prefer a open price or the open market price. They ask the seller whatever the prices they are going to charge for the product, they have to give it in the sealed form, and looking at the price, generally they will decide, the buyers will decide from whom they are going to buy. This specifically happens in case of the monopsony buyer, and also typically all these government offices and the public utility services where the regulatory authorities, generally they ask for the quotation from the different seller that whatever the prices they are going to charge for doing a specific job. It is always in the sealed form, typically known as the tender price, and we always follow the lower tender price. People generally, if you look at this, the regular practice that the if someone has quoted a lower price, lower tender price, generally they gets the deal. So the typical example of sealed bid pricing strategy is the tender, which generally happen in case of the limited monopsony and also in the government offices where the accounting accountability is very high. In case of sealed bid pricing strategy, markup, generally it's follow a markup strategy, and markup strategy where there is a cost of production plus some margin. But here the challenge comes, what should be the margin, because if there are 10 bidders and each of them they are bidding for it, the when they decides the margin, they cannot quote a lower price, lower margin, because it may happen that when they are quoting a lower margin and that leads to a lower price, which looks unrealistic and which gives an impression that they are not going to go, they are not going to give a qualitative job. So in that case also they are not going to get the tender. And also in the case of high bidding price, when they put up a high margin, they are not going to get the tender, because that looks like in a very high level. So margin is generally, fixing of the margin is challenge in case of the sealed bid pricing strategy, even if they follow a markup pricing, because it's not a open price, rather it's a closed price. So it's difficult to know the what are the margin of the other competitor who is bidding for this typical goods or the typical services. Then we have retail pricing, and how retail pricing is different from the producer pricing or the wholesale pricing. What is the value chain over here? Producer generally produce the product, then they send it to the wholesaler. So producer sold, generally sells the product in one price to the wholesaler, and from retailer buy from the wholesaler and sell it in the market. So every time there is some value addition, and if you look at whatever the price is charged by the producer, it is not going to be the same by the wholesaler. They will add their margin, and from wholesaler when it comes to retailer, that is again their margin is being added, and finally whatever the price we get, that is the maximum retail price. If you have seen in all this product, it's written MRP is this much. So maximum retail price, and in the maximum retail price, generally the retail commissioner is, the commission of the retail is added over here. So retail pricing is one, at that price generally the consumer buys the product from the retailer, and in case of maximum retail price, the retailer commission is added. Now what is the technique for this retail pricing, or what is the pricing technique generally followed by the retailer? One example is the everyday low pricing, that is generally known as the EDLP. And under this technique, generally a low price is charged throughout the year and there is no special discount. So typical example, if you look at, generally we call it the Big Bazaar, or whether it's the Walmart, or whether it's the dollar store, or whether it's the EG shop, there are number of chain, if you look at number of supermarket, they charges low price constantly throughout the year, and in that case there is no other discount, rather than because they are charging a lower price throughout the year, and this pricing strategy is known as the everyday low pricing. And here also the consumer have the understanding that if you are going to that particular store, throughout the year every day they are paying a lower price for all these product as compared to the other product. Then the other technique is high low pricing, and high low pricing is the high prices on the regular basis coupled with discount to promotion the product. This is generally followed by the retailer. Typically the brand, when they want to make it a branded product, generally they always say that since it's a good brand, they have to follow a high price. They have to follow a high price on the regular basis, but they give some discount to promote the product. This is typically adopted by farms which have a high overhead expenses cannot afford low pricing. The typical example, if you look at the whether it's about good brand, whether it's about Tanishq, whether it's about any good brand of garments, every day they charge a higher price because they charge that price for their brand. And on a particular day or on a particular occasion, they give discount when they have to promote their product. Then in that technique, we have one more pricing that is known as value pricing, where it's the value for money. Generally, they say that what is the perceived value attached to the product. Retailer generally, they take a judgment on the basis of the perceived value of the product from the consumer point of view. And on that basis, generally they do a value pricing. If the consumer is giving a having a very high perceived value for the product, they charges a high price. And if it is a low perceived value, they generally charge a low price. Then we have administer pricing, and administer price is generally related to price charged by the monopolist and therefore determined by the consideration other than marginal cost. And prices are those that are statutorily determined by the government. This is typically known as the administer price. Then we have export pricing, and export pricing comes into picture because there is international transaction taking place after typically the when the international trade is there or the when the liberalization and the globalization has taken place. And international trade, either we import the product where we have to make the payment, the domestic economy has to make the payment, and or it is exported, so where we receive the payment. So when the export price is fixed, in this case the determinant for the export price is need to check where this product is getting exported, what is the income level of that country, what is the taste and preference of the consumers of that country, what is the exchange rate between the currency of that country where the transaction is taking place and the domestic currency, what is the tariff and custom duties in that country to the trading, identify and also to identify all the competitors who supply the same product in the same market. Because export price is something where the domestic product is getting sold in the foreign market. So pricing is not on the basis of the domestic business environment, rather this is on the basis of the foreign country's business environment where the product is getting sold or where the product is getting exported. So that's why here the exporter, when they're fixing up the price, they need to consider what is the income level, what is the taste and preferences, what is the exchange rate, what is the tariff, customer duty, and also one of the important factors they have to look into that, who are the other competitors or who are the other supplier who is exporting the product to that particular region or that particular location. So with this completed our discussion on the product pricing. And if you remember, in the product pricing we discuss about the different kind of pricing that is based on competition, that is based on the goal of the firm, that is based on the cost, that is based on the cyclical changes, that is based on the product life cycle. And also we talked about two pricing, basically one is the multi product pricing, where pricing is decided on the basis of the combined marginal revenue, and the second one is the price discrimination, which is generally practiced by the monopolist when they charge different prices to the different consumer group in different market and different time period. So with this we completed all this topic, whatever we listed in the this typical course, or whatever has to be covered in this typical course.